Good morning and welcome from all around the world to Structural Heart Life Cases, broadcasting directly from the Cardiac Catheterization Laboratory at Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City. My name is Pedro Moreno. I am a professor of medicine and director of quality assurance for cardiology. I'll be your moderator today. We'd love to hear from you, so please send us all your questions through the website. And remember that you can view all the previous structural heart cases at www.cccLifeCases.org. We have a great case for you today, so let me take you to the cardiac cath lab at the Mount Sinai Hospital for the case.
All right, good morning to all our viewers, and sorry for little delay. This was audio visual, it's not because of me. That I'm always well prepared before the time. So this is just some issue with the new room. As you can see, the quality of the image is fantastic, but we still have to have some connections established. We thought it was working. So we'll have a little modified way for the echo. And welcome to all our viewers for this structural heart, very interesting case of valve-in-valve. And we're presenting predominantly with the bioprosthetic regurgitation. On my right side is Dr. Keeney, Dr. Gilbert Tang, Sahil Khera, and we have our fellows and Dr. Stem Larakis on the echo, and Dr. Benjamin Salter is our chief anesthesiologist. So with that note, we are ready to start this case. Knowing that you can start crossing the valve and we can start presenting our case. So these are our supporters and all faculty involved. Uh-huh. Disclosures are shown here. Basically, it's a case number 41. 73-year-old male presented with class 3 symptoms of heart failure. Patient was admitted outside hospital and has a bad restrictive lung disease. FEV1 is 48% of predicted. The head in the past, patient had both surgical EVR and CABG in 2012. 21 millimeter mitral flow bioprosthetic aortic valve with a 4-vessel bypass, and patient was recently, as I mentioned, admitted outside the hospital with heart failure and was found to have severe aortic prosthesis with regurgitation with some gradient, but predominantly severe regurgitation and EF of 45%. And actually, TE also showed bioprosthetic leaflet with severe regurgitation. We'll show you actually. And the prelude, we did the angiogram. And patient has a patent 3 grafts, only occluded by SVG to RPDA, which gets collateral. So let's ask Gilbert. Patient is it's not a patient on dialysis. And about exactly 9 years ago, the valve was implanted and now degenerated. Do you think usual, little unusual, or?
9 years, I think, the patient had mitral flow already back in his 60s. So we know that the prosthetic valve durability is depends on the age. So the younger you are, the lower the durability you are. So that this mitral flow valve is actually pretty good, because on average, they've shown that the durability of mitral flow is average 5 to 6 years only. So this is actually pretty good.
So 9 year, patient was seven, at that time, patient was 62.
Yeah, exactly.
So good, okay, so all expected. Now this is our transthoracic echocardiogram, which was done before by Dr. Larakis. I know that Larakis maybe point out what we are seeing here.
Yes, so this is a 5-chamber view of the aortic valve. You can appreciate the severe aortic regurgitation. Or you want me to show the live?
Maybe we'll come back to the live, because live will require a little changing the direction. And we'll come back to the live and we have showed. And anything unusual here?
Yeah, I mean, the leaflets are very thickened, and also there is a significant aortic regurgitation, which is very eccentric because of the flail leaflet of the bioprosthesis.
Okay. Now, anything you worry about, any the valve dehiscence, or there was some question, very small clot?
Yeah, on the long axis view, on your left, you will see some small, funny texture material that most likely is thrombus on the leaflet on the ventricular side of the valve.
Okay.
The prosthesis.
All right. So with that note, and then we did the CTA. with the aortic annulus and LVOT. Gilbert, you want to comment
on
it?
Yeah, so this is a 21 mitral flow valve. You can see, depends on your zone in, the internal diameter, you can go by the app, but you also look at by CTs. You can see it's around 20 millimeters in diameter, perimeter 64. LVOT is a little bit larger. This patient has reduced LVEF. Next slide. You can see sinotubular junction and sinuses are plenty big. Next slide. So in terms of the VTC or virtual valve to coronary distance, you can see this is plenty. You can 7.5 millimeter to the left main. This patient is also grafted with previous CABG, so we're less concerned about coronary obstruction. You can see here with a little box to show the relative distance between that and the root is also quite generous. We can also show you on fluoro afterwards. Next slide. Access is very straightforward here, you can see. Next slide.
And what about the access point of view? Now, Sahil, we have any problem in getting your sheath?
No, it's very straightforward.
Yeah.
Okay, what sheath we have put here?
18 gore.
Okay.
Yeah, we prefer to go 18 French gore instead of inline, so in case we have to post dilate, it would be easier in terms of exchanges. But so you can see this is the valve in valve app. Even though the true ID says 17, but you have to see sometimes the valve stretches. And that's something that we always correlate with the CT to make sure we put in the right valve plus transcatheter valve. How this looks on the right side of the app. Next slide.
So based on the app, it is evolute 23 millimeter?
Yeah, either way, it's evolute 23, but it does give us some comfort that the matching will be better in this case because the valve was stretched.
Okay.
That's probably why there's AI.
Right. So basically, that's where we are with this patient with bioprosthetic severe regurgitation and high STS risk mortality and patient has a severe COPD.
The probe. What are you doing?
Yeah. So with that note, we can go back to the fluoro, and we are in process of
crossing the
aortic valve now. And Nutel?
Nothing. We tried with AR1.
Yeah. Let's go to long access. Please, mid esophageal long access, so we can see where the catheter and wires were crossing the valve.
But you crossed earlier a little bit. What happened?
I think it was from outside the valve frame. Yeah.
Okay. This is AR2?
AR2. AR1 also was too big.
Sorry?
Yeah. Okay.
I'm getting a no torque. Keep asking for a few other catheters,
yeah.
I guess.
So the question is, you know, always these very difficult sometimes to cross, even the patient has a aortic regurgitation. A significant, should you feel
give
like
better,
maybe you can push the pigtail directly?
I think the issue here, Dr. Sharma, is that the sinus is very large. You saw it on the CAT scan. So with a small prosthesis and a large sinus, it's more challenging typically to cross than a small sinuses.
But question is not a stenotic valve, but yes,
right.
Going with the pigtail.
Tell them to give a diagnostic lima also.
So one thing we've done is also use echo to help as well. You can see here, and see it directly on echo, but you can certainly take a look at the...
Yeah, why don't we go to LAO view, no? Yeah. The right in the valve frame. Now, Gilbert, maybe you can comment on what are the new the valve selection of the surgical valve at present when you are deciding in a younger patient, knowing that that patient 10, 12, 14 years later may need a tower. So what comes into equation?
That's a great question, Dr. Sharma. So the newer generation valve, particularly the Edwards Inspiris, has a hinge. So one of the issues that we've seen with surgical valve like this one is too small.
Okay.
But mismatch. So that one has a hinge. So potentially, when you do valve in valve, you can put a slightly larger transcatheter valve and expand the hinge, so avoid a prosthesis patient mismatch. So that's the latest technology from Edwards Inspiris, and that's been our preferred valve in younger patients because of that reason.
And we have seen that we have gone into the ventricle now. So only question is,
AR1 was also despite, I know you said, you know, the sinuses were large and small valve.
That's right.
So you need a smaller catheter. Even AR1 was large. Yeah. So then you go to the next smaller catheter would be either a no torque or a diagnostic Lima.
That's right.
Catheter.
Yeah. Sometimes we also use a guy instead of a catheter for stiffness, for support in stenotic valves. So.
So now question is to show that ongoing echo live. Yes.
So okay. Sam, you want to comment?
Good.
Yeah, so we have crossed the valve. The ejection fraction is, as we say, 40 to 45%. The RV is very decreased function, at least moderate decreased. The patient has moderate MR, moderate ER, and a severe valvular aortic regurgitation through the bioprosthesis because of the FLEL leaflet of the bioprosthesis. And there is no thrombus. I know the patient came on Sunday and he was on heparin.
Okay.
The leaflets look clean with no evidence of any thrombus material that was seen in the planning TE. Okay.
And the gradient point of view was just less than 10 millimeter gradient. In this case, we don't have to worry about the coronaries because patient has a good three grafts. So otherwise, valve in valve, always that question comes, decision making, what to do. Because of the coronaries, sometimes the decision could be done, selecting patient for repeat surgery, patient for going for re-SAVR because of the heightened coronary obstruction, putting valve in the valve.
Okay, going up.
Yeah. Okay.
So we already put in the sentinel, so we just have to watch it when we cross the arch.
It says, would you comment on residual gradients in this case and which valve do you think is the best?
Yeah, so I mean, actually for valve in valve, both valves have been tried. A lot of publications that particularly when you have 26, 29 millimeter, probably gradient is equal, but in the smaller one, smaller valves, with the self-expanding, with the evolute, you have lower gradient compared to balloon expandable. So it's a function of the valve size.
Okay, TE up, please.
Yeah. Hmm? So now, so in this particular case, and we know that always you leave 10 to 12 millimeter gradient, and many times we fracture the valve frame in order to decrease that gradient further. But in this particular case, mitral flow cannot be fractured.
Okay, good.
Okay.
So, okay, I think we're ready to go. You can see here we try to minimize the parallax. We're trying to minimize the parallax of the evolute and the surgical valve, right? So I think this is probably the best we can start here.
So let's make it very clear. Your parallax of both the valves have been removed in this particular view.
That's the best view,
You're going to start.
Okay, 120.
Okay, I'm holding.
150.
And I see that no dye being given, huh?
Everything no dye because you have a frame there in place.
Okay. That's your landmark.
Yes.
Very good. Okay, 80, please. Okay, you can see.
So you see the pacing. Pacing was very important for it to stay. So now you wait for a few minutes. Just make sure it's stable.
And then you do the
another cine. Go to some other view.
You can go to another view to make sure. So floral, please.
More. No, you don't see it well here. Okay, this is okay.
Yeah. No, I want to take the parallax out of the...
Right now, we are taking the parallax of the evolute valve.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can see any of that.
Stay there.
Yeah. That looks pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think this looks very good.
Okay.
Everyone agree?
All right. Okay. Let's deliver.
So essentially, I'm holding it in neutral position.
We'll pull the wire back because the nose
pull the wire back, centralize the wire,
Okay, 180. Benji, you have to control the pressure for us, please. 180.
Wait, I know, but blood pressure has to go low.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
Move forward, please.
I am forward. Good. Yeah, forward. I am forward.
Good. Okay, still into it. Push forward.
Yes.
Push forward.
Yeah. Don't push too much. Wait.
No, you have.
Let it
detach? No.
No, not yet.
You're putting too much pressure.
Yeah.
Wait.
Don't go forward.
Yeah.
No.
Pull the wire back.
I know. Untwist.
No. 150.
Who's pushing?
Yeah, one twister.
Why didn't it separate yet?
Because of the nose.
No, it could be detached. Wait.
No, it's not.
No, it's not. It's not detached.
Wait.
It's not detached.
Wait 1 second. Okay. Don't push like that.
I think let's just rotate it.
Yeah.
Be careful. No, but sometimes we rotate.
Yeah, we are.
You see that there is a little bit.
Yeah. Okay. 150. Let's do another view. Here, so you can see.
Why don't you pull back? It may be detached.
No, it's not.
No, it's attached.
It's attached.
Attached?
No, it's not. The capsule is already well. It's the tab that.
Or sometimes we just rotate.
Don't push.
So that's a very important issue.
Can you
wait,
push
wait.
One?
That able to detach. Yes. Okay. Good. Now it detached, right?
No. And then let me twist. There you go.
Okay.
Watch. Yeah.
Okay. Pull the wire back. Center. Good.
Good. Excellent. Okay.
All right.
Very good. So you can see you have to have patience before you release to make sure.
It's not that.
Not only patients, maybe a little bit of beta blockers too.
You can see excellent here. Okay, back up at 30 now, please.
Okay. Bring the pigtail in.
Yep. 1 second, Sam. We'll do an aortogram.
Aortogram, and then we'll show the screen.
So, Anu, describe to us the maneuvers that you used to detach.
Yeah. No, essentially, we went forward. You saw that we were advancing forward and then keep rotating a little bit. Just cautiously rotate it.
We want to be very gentle
to make sure that it will not.
Perfect.
Pop
out. That. Very nice. Well expanded.
Loro, bring back the pigtail out.
So
okay,
advance.
Sam, you want to show us the echo?
Yeah. Bring the change the direction of the screen, please, and change to the echo screen. Good. A little more. Very good.
Yeah, very good position of the valve. Long axis view.
Showing it, yeah.
Color on. No PVL. No valvular AR.
Little modified.
Pull back.
Short axis. Little short axis.
Okay.
Indian terminology we call jugad.
Beautiful position.
Give me a pigtail.
No PVL. No valvular AR.
Out already.
No, pigtail. So the hemodynamic.
You want to go inside?
Right? Hemodynamics.
Coronary
yeah.
flow.
Just to get the hemo.
Okay.
Perfect. Coronary flow. Left main open.
Beautiful.
I know the patient has bypass. Something we look. Let's go in the stomach.
Yeah. So now we are going to show the hemodynamic. That what is the gradient?
Yes.
Now screen wise, can you show the lower part of the screen on the left lower?
Yes,
sir. Yes. Sir. Yeah. Beautiful. Beautiful. Yes.
It's a long sheath.
No PVL.
All right, Pedro, let's make the assessment or guess.
Go ahead.
What will be the gradient? Less than 10, 10 to 20, or more than 20? Three
definitely,
categories.
Definitely less than 10.
All right. I would still say will be about 15, 20.
Mean
because 23 millimeter. Yeah.
We got mean, by echo, mean gradient 10, peak gradient 21.
Okay. Let's see. We'll confirm the hemodynamics.
Give me
the
flush.
And we have to flush everything,
re-zero
everything, yeah. Yeah. Actually, it's a little more than, no, but let them flush yet. No,
no
they are not flushed.
No, we have to re-zero
right
flush.
Very high gradient, yeah. We have to zero everything.
Zero.
So now question is, Gilbert, to you, if the gradient more than 30, what are you going to do now?
You can potentially fracture the valve. Mitral flow is fracturable. Are you concerned about coronary obstruction? Not in this case, but in general, you can just pulse dilate gently. So the ID is 20, we'll just go with 20 true.
Zero balloon. Again? Hold
just
on.
Expand
It'll
the frame
be
because all these prosthetic valve has some element of stiffness on the leaflet. But okay. I think this is a very good result.
Let's see. Letter G.
Now we're talking.
Yes. Okay.
Beautiful.
Wow.
10.
That definitely, nope. 148 to 160, 12.
Yeah, 12. 10 to 12.
12. 12. So I said 10 to 12. Yeah. 10
no,
to
no,
20.
No.
Okay. No, I said 10 to 20.
I
was in that category. 147, 159.
Actually,
okay.
We can
to be precise, 12 millimeter gradient. Yes.
Any PVL?
Okay.
I think this one we can leave it.
What we need to, oh, 12, definitely we leave it. Yeah.
No, no PVL, no.
Yeah.
The other thing that we noticed, as soon as the valve become functional at 80%, the systolic pressure immediately ran up. Yeah. So we fixed the AI at that point already, I think. Okay. So.
12. All right.
Get us a wire yeah. so we can.
So now the big task remains the closure and take the sentinel out.
First take yeah. the sentinel.
First the sentinel out.
Okay, good.
Okay,
very nice.
Good. All right. So, any question, Pedro, from your side to our team here, and then we go to our slide presentation.
Tee up, please. One moment. Stamp, tee up. Yeah. Please. Okay, good.
I think it's a good opportunity to remind the audience how Mount Sinai does these cases, the crossing in the RAO projection, which is not done everywhere else. But we believe the prosthetic valves are the only ones that we cross in the RAO projection. Very interesting how this IR1 was too big and how eventually the cross was uneventful and then the procedure was very straightforward. I think it's a very good illustration of valve in valve, specifically for a patient that doesn't have a severe calcification of the aortic valve.
Beautiful. Okay, so let's go back to our slide presentation, please. So we continue, and that is the theme today, is the give some data of the comparative tower valve trials. A lot has been published. You know, these are the our family of transcatheter aortic valves. The on the top, in balloon expandable, in the middle, self-expanding, and the third category is the modified. With the accurate Lotus and so. So these are all the valves. Some of them have been discontinued, as we know. Centara, Lotus, they all are out. But this is basically what we have and how we deal with them day to day. So longest term comparative data are available with the choice randomized clinical trial of 5-year follow-up. Though I'll skip the 1 year, which you know the new 1 year because of the paravalvular leak, regurgitation, the core valve was inferior to the Sapien valve. So we're talking about the 5-year data. And these are the 5-year, about 120 plus patients. And you see that about 50% death occurs in these patients. So dad, see that about 40-45% at 5 years. And what they basically is, if you take the death from any balloon expandable versus self-expanding, the death from any cause, non-significant, the stroke non-significant, and the vascular complication non-significant, except the pacemaker. Pacemaker is higher, as you can see there, with the self-expanding, which new. Another good advantage we saw, we always talk about which valve is going to do good. Now we're not talking about the against surgery. Comparative valve, which will give us a better valve area at follow-up and minimal gradient. As you can see here, at 5 years, self-expanding valve area remained 1.9. From 2 went down to 1.9 only. Compared to balloon expandable, 2 became 1.6. With a residual gradient became 12 in the balloon expandable and 6.9 in the self-expanding. So clearly, the plus, the long term, it did much better in terms of like hemodynamics and so. Now, and that led to also this part of the bioprosthetic valve dysfunction, that structural valve deterioration was noted lower with the self-expanding compared to balloon expandable valve, except that you will have more paravalvular leak in the self-expanding, which we expected. And of course, you see that valve thrombosis, which we learned more in the PARTNER 2 trial at 5-year follow-up, we are concerned. And definitely we saw much lower with the self-expanding, with the endocarditis remaining similar. So basically the conclusion of these authors on this choice 5-year data was that clinical outcomes after transfemoral tower with early generation balloon expandable and self-expanding valves are not statistically significantly different with limited statistical power because these are the 120 cases and half of them were dead. Forward flow hemodynamics was significantly better with the self-expanding valve. Moderate to severe structural valve deterioration was common, but occurred more frequently with the balloon expandable valve, as we know. So then we have comparative data of the accurate NEO. SCOPE 1 trial, you're all aware, the Sapien 3 against Accurate Neo, and basically Accurate Neo was inferior to Sapien Tower. Then we scope 2 trial, randomized trial, which compared Accurate Neo against self-expanding Evolute Val, Core Val Evolute, another about 800 patients with a primary endpoint, and basically showed that higher cardiovascular death and trend towards all-cause death in Accurate Neo group compared to Core Val. And of course, other things, it was not non-inferior. So basically, and higher residual aortic regurgitation at 30 days led to that the Val was inferior or not non-inferior to the comparator. So therefore, it basically the transfemoral transcatheter aortic valve with a self-expanding Accurate Neo did not meet non-inferiority compared with the self-expanding Core valve in terms of all-cause death or stroke and associated with lower incidence of new permanent pacemaker. So that was plus. But in the secondary analysis, Accurate Neo was associated with more moderate or severe aortic regurgitation at 30 days and cardiac death at 30 days and 1 year. Now we know that I'll touch basically the latest trial in this field a little later. So then we have another data of the France TAVI registry, which is basically the propensity match, not a randomized. Until now, we showed randomized. Propensity match TAVI registry, which has multiple publications and large number of patients, about 4,000 in each group. The self-expanding and balloon expandable, and patients were followed for 1 year. And there, actually, you found some lower mortality, as you see in the balloon expandable group versus self-expanding. This is one study which has shown that. And so now rest of the other point, moderate paravalvular leak, pacemaker, all went against the self-expanding group in this particular. Now, except if you see the mean gradient, the residual mean gradient was much lower in the self-expanding group versus balloon expandable. So this basically the present study suggests that use of self-expanding THV was associated with a lower, with higher risk of paravalvular regurgitation and higher in-hospital and two-year mortality compared to the use of balloon expandable. But remember, no matter how much propensity match you do, it's always the issue. You need to trust more of the randomized trial. Then the SALT TAVI, which was presented 2 years ago in TCT, now has come in the publication in the European Heart Journal. And this basically trial had two factorial design, general anesthesia versus conscious sedation, and secondly, self-expanding versus balloon expandable valve, about 450 patients total. And basically found, as you can see here, that all-cause mortality and primary endpoint, the 28% in the self-expanding, 25.9% in the balloon expandable, little favor of balloon expandable, but the stroke rate in balloon expandable was 4.7%. and 0.5 in the self-expanding valve. And of course, we knew about the pacemaker, trend towards higher pacemaker with a self-expanding valve. These are the individual endpoint as shown here. And definitely that the Evolute, which was used in this clearly, was not the Evolute Pro Plus, that is what we use to decrease the paravalvular leak. And we know some of them issue could be because of the paravalvular leak. Now then, we know that few new valves, new trials going on. One is the Accurate Neo 2, which is a different than the Accurate Neo because of the additional cuff and the larger outer skirt. And this is a trial ongoing at present, and we are part of it, Accurate IDE, with both Gilbert Tang and Anukini at the site PI. And basically, this valve is evaluating Accurate Neo 2 with the Core valve or Sapien, any one of them. And the primary endpoint, basically the composite of all-cause mortality, stroke, life-threatening major bleed, and so an efficacy endpoint is mortality and disabling stroke at 1 year. And I'll ask maybe Anu to comment on it, that how we are now enrolling in the trial, and what is the experience with this valve, Accurate Neo.
Yeah, I mean, enrollment, we are reasonably good. Ever since, you know, we have recovered comparison. Essentially, I think what's happening also, since it is right now intermediate to low risk, that's where we are having the issue in enrollment.
Yeah, you still remain the high risk and not in the low risk. So, but since big advantage of this valve will be that coronary access.
Yeah, coronary access would be a good advantage, and it's a combination of both, I would say, since you know, the way the valve frame is, it is both combination of balloon expandable as well as self-expandable. So we hope the coronary access should be better because the bigger, I would say, the diamonds at the top. Yeah.
Gilbert, you want to say some statement on that?
Yeah, no, I think the Neo 2 has a good combination of the, you know, at least in the trial, low pacemaker rate, the frame profile, as Dr. Kinney mentioned, is very low profile in terms of coronary access. I think if we can get commercial alignment, it could be a very interesting valve in terms of in the market. So we'll see. The system is also very flexible, the eye sleeve, with the delivery system as well. So it makes it very trackable and difficult anatomy.
The another trial which are ready to start will be the PART and Roxana Maran with Herman and DGA, the three PIs, a SMART trial. And that is a small annulus randomized evolute versus Sapien trial. And this basically has a after randomization, of course, patient will be followed with a two primary endpoint at 1 year. One is the MACE of death, stroke, or rehospitalization, and secondly, bioprosthetic valve dysfunction. So all those will be, and we'll be starting that soon, right? A small annulus, always question comes, which valve is better? And this is, I'm glad that Medtronic is doing this study to really answer the question for the small valves. Now there is another trial ongoing, which is called Landmark trial. I'm one of the study consultant for it. And this is the My Valve, comparing the contemporary Evolute and Sapien. This is done out of United States, out of India, and will be comparing with a 2-to-1 allocation with a primary endpoint of death and stroke in 1 and 2 years. So these are the three new valves. So let's come back to that, which valve do you select? So this is actually from the choice. They put it down, balloon expandable and self-expanding. As you see here, you have too much calcium, go to self-expanding. Excessive root angulation, low coronary height, go to Sapien, along with the, if you have need for re-access, Sapien. Now, I'll ask both of my colleagues here, the Gilbert, tell us about your commissioner alignment you talk about when you are putting the our Evolute valve for particularly re-access, because re-access is a big issue. And we know the trial has shown that after many times the valve, you'd want to do coronary re-access, always remain issue. Yeah.
Yeah, so actually, if you look at our current live case, we can even show the floor image. The way we do it, we put the flash port at 3 o'clock, running the conventional travel clock. And you can see, can we show the floor image here? You can just see this very nicely. Yeah. This is the LAO view. So the left main is to the right. You can see the C-tab is the inner curve of the ascending aorta. That means you're well aligned, just like with the surgical valve. So this will be kind of how you determine whether the commissures are aligned. And by just doing putting the flash port at 3 o'clock, and you can see when we deploy the valve, the head marker is facing you typically at the RAO projection. And that's another sign that you'll have a good alignment.
What he's trying to tell us is that the flush port will 3 o'clock. That means the head mark should be in the...
Facing you directly.
That's the way we do it before release. Yeah. But they are coming up with a newer generation valve that before you completely release, there will be another tab at the bottom of the valve to tell us where is the C-tab facing. Yeah. So if we think we are not happy, we can recapture it again, orient a little bit better. And then to orient, very important, don't do the reorientation in the ascending. Go down to the descending. Then your C-tab should change again, or the head mark should change again. Then you come back in. Wow. Very clear. Do not do in the ascending. Risk of a stroke is there. So recapture, go down in the descending part, and then come back. So that is their newer generation valve.
And we actually working release, with the, making your update on your tower cathode in terms of selective engagement. Are you ready to show something at this time? That video of the new tower cathode, and then we'll come back to that presentation later?
No. Huh? End of the presentation.
No, but they can show it now. Yeah, they can show it. Yeah. So I think this is right now, because the coronary re-access is a major issue, and particularly when you get to the patient's younger age, patient with a coronary artery disease, and that is where this whole issue of the field is going to emerge. Yeah.
So this is the second version of the tower cathode, which we've released, and the app is also available now, both on App Store as well as Google. You know, again, it's free if you can see that. So what does what are the changes? So we can see how the entire access, because of animation was deep down embedded into the first valve, but right now we have changed that. Immediately you will be able to see the animation, and we have added a lot of cases. So, you know, viewers always kept us asking, give or show some cases. So cases of engagement of CATH as well as engagement of how to do PCI. So we are, I want to show the animation. Go back. So if you can start showing the animation. Yeah.
Play. Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Okay. Yeah.
So, see, this is the bird's eye view, which we can tell you exactly how the catheter should be manipulated and how you get into the right diamond, and you know what are the wires we need to use. Everything has been described and mentioned. So if you see here, this is what we are showing. So once you are in the right diamond, you can advance the guide or the diagnostic catheter. Then this is animation of the PCI. You advance the wire and do the PCI. But the same thing, if you have issues with having your device inside, you can use the guide extension. Everything has to be very gentle. And when you're coming out, again, you need a wire. You see that?
Yep.
And how you remove the guide or the catheter away from the diamonds.
And it's available now, or it's...
It's been released.
It's been released.
Long. And okay. Then there is a web app.
And then there is a web app, and
web
we can...
Essentially, what we are trying is it's a website that is available. So these are all the changes, added cases, offline functionality, which means that you don't need internet access. So you are able to view it anywhere at any time. And more important is user interface has completely changed. So very easy navigation so that you can either read step by step which catheter to use, or you can, you know, see the animations, whatever you like the best. And there's a search function. That's what we have, you know, which people like.
Okay. Yep. Okay. And then we go back to the slides now. So that we complete our presentation. So then the other question is re-access. We already spoke high risk for permanent pacemaker, and then bicuspid valve and pure AI. They favored the self-expanding and the degenerative surgical bioprocesses. As you know, both are good. Being basically from the data point of view, issue remains expected durability and hemodynamics. We know in the choice trial that at 5 years hemodynamics were better with the core valve versus so. Now we also published the review of the optimal device selection in the JAMA Cardiology, and basically put down three. Actually, Lotus is out now, not available. But we, based on the available data, so we put this that most aortic stenosis patients are suitable for all valve types. Certain scenario may slightly favor one particular design, and the basically Sapien 3 large annulus. Horizontal aorta, high pre-procedural risk of pacemaker, extensive CAD, low coronary height. Evolute, dense subannular calcium, intolerant to rapid pacing, tower in small femoral arteries, and valve in valve favoring self-expanding and subclavian approach, and so. So therefore, I think this, I really like this editorial by John Webb. The key is that both valves have a large and option. Opinionated following, rather than asking which valve is best, perhaps the more pertinent question in which valve is best for that particular patient. Patient comorbidities, anatomical factors, and procedural concerns may ultimately favor one valve design over other. Outcomes such as mortality, stroke, vascular injury, bleeding, paravalvular leaks have captured our attention in the past, but they are okay. But outcomes improve and plateau. The focus may move away from concern of early adoption to newer issues such as implication of AV injury, hemodynamic function, coronary access, durability, repeatability, and cost. which remains the issue. So just to sum up our two take-home messages, both balloon expandable and self-expanding valves have shown similar results of MACE in numerous randomized clinical trials and propensity match cohorts with severe AS. Balloon expandable valves have significantly lower permanent pacemaker and slightly higher bioprosthetic valve dysfunction compared to self-expanding valve. Second, choice of a tower valve should take into consideration of ejection fraction, peripheral vasculature, valve anatomy, LVOT calcium, root lie, pacemaker need, coronary heights, and coronary re-access for future need for coronary intervention. If all equal, tower valve cost will come into consideration as current valve cost is 6 times higher than the surgical aortic valve. 5,000 versus 30,000.
That's right.
So big, big difference. So let's come back to our three questions. Following are the randomized clinical trial comparing self-expanding versus balloon expandable tower or TAVI, except scope 2, choice, SALT TAVI, and FRANCE TAVI. Clearly, FRANCE TAVI was the propensity match, not the randomized trial. Then, following statements are true regarding the results of balloon expandable versus self-expanding tower trial, except choice trial data at 5 years showed less structural valve degeneration with self-expanding valve. SALT TAVI showed lower mortality after balloon expandable versus self-expanding. SALT TAVI showed higher stroke rates after self-expanding versus balloon expandable valve, and scope 2 trial showed accurate NEO to be inferior to self-expanding. And answer that is C, because SALT TAVI showed lower stroke rate with a self-expanding valve compared to balloon expandable. And the last is, following are the appropriate choices for the selection of self-expanding valve or balloon expandable tower in particular AS scenario, except self-expanding valve in severe LVOT root calcification, self-expanding valve in pure aortic regurgitation, self-expanding valve in avoiding need for fast pacing, and lastly, self-expanding valve in patient with future coronary re-access. As we know, we have spoken about it, and of course, a lot of work being done with the Gilbert about this commissural tab, and so maybe re-access will be a little easier with the current Evolute valve. And as Dr. Keeney mentioned, that there are a lot of work being done at present in the stent design besides the app, that which will give the valve hole in front of the coronary, particularly left vein. With that note, we conclude our today's presentation. The vascular access has been closed, and right?
Yeah,
it all has been done. And I know that Dr. Moreno just had to leave, but we really thank everyone, our viewers, and keep asking the question and keep visiting us on our structural interventions through the cccliveCases.org. Thank you very much.